Greetings, everybody. This is Ville Vallo from the project VV, and at the moment you have the pleasure of watching Sonic Perspectives. Take good care now.
Here in my heart, an endless sorrow, tearing apart all the children I could have been.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another interview of Sonic Perspectives. My guest today is Ville Vallo, who's releasing his first solo album, Neon Noir, in January 2023. Ville, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah.
It's been quite a while since I've been in the realm of rock and roll, so it's quite exciting for me.
I know, and it's great to have you back for sure.
And hopefully back in Canada as well really soon. So
fingers
we're working.
Crossed.
Indeed, we're working on it, and hopefully we can make it happen later on.
Yeah. Well, as I mentioned in the intro, we're here to discuss your first solo album, Neon Noir. It must be a great time for you to experience a fresh start, right?
Yeah, it's sort of, yeah, I've had the opportunity of starting from a clean slate, and I was trying to figure out what kind of music I should be doing, which is actually the wrong thing to do, you know, thinking with your brain. So instead, I ended up picking up the acoustic guitar and sort of finding my way back to the sort of hymn-esque sound. So it's very melancholy, but you can still dance to it. And somewhere in between, nowadays I'm calling somewhere in between Black Sabbath and Depeche Mode. I think that's quite close to the truth. And it was quite funny at the end of the day, you know, feeling like a zebra who can't change his stripes. This feels like a continuation of what we started with him. And I've sort of jokingly called it so that the hymn where the Hobbit to my Lord of the Rings,
right,
to the Lord of the Rings BV. So it comes from the same sort of place, but it has quite a few new twists and turns, I hope.
Mm-hmm. Well, I like the definition, Black Sabbath and Depeche Mode meeting in between. Yeah. That's perfect, actually, yeah. Even before we go into the musical aspect of the album, let me ask you about your logo, which is a spin-off of the heartogram of him. It almost feels like you're carefully planning the transition between him and you as a solo artist, right?
Well, I wasn't sort of, I can't consider myself being clever, but I thought that it was quite a clever thing to do. I was messing about with the heartogram. I was trying to find a way how to use it, because this is definitely not me trying to burn my bridges. So, and when we're coming on tour, we're going to be playing half the set will be hymn songs and half of the set will be the new stuff. So
right.
It's like a stepping stone between the past and the future, I call it. So I think it was, you know, heartogram is one of the better things I've been involved in creating. And I thought that it was not only interesting, but important to carry it along, because a lot of people have still it tattooed on their bodies, and it means so much more than just the band. I thought that I'm just updating a bit, and everybody will understand that both are as valid, the original heartogram and the V-gram, as I call it, or V-gram. Well, once again, you know, talking about the same things as just a second ago, I can still smell the sweat of the guys from him. So even though it's been a few years, it was a big deal for me. It was such an important band for myself. We grew up together with the lads, and I thought that we ended it in the most beautiful way a band can, you know, without being at each other's throats. So in that sense, I wanted to continue sort of the legacy or whatever you want to call it, you know, it's important not to denounce. A lot of people who start their solo projects or whatever, they want to denounce the past and do something absurdly different. And this wasn't definitely the case. But then again, you know, working on the album, I didn't have to sort of compromise scheduling wise and sound wise or whatever wise, production wise. So I was able to put all my musical perversions on the album, and this time around have maybe a bit more of a sort of like alternative rock vibe in there on an occasion. And more of these sort of like early 80s, new wavy sort of the Chameleons, the more rock stuff, and then Sisters of Mercy and the Susie Sue and the Banshees, those sort of like jangly guitars and all that stuff, which I wasn't able to sort of like force my way into the him album so much. So I'm glad I brought the 80s back along.
Of course.
Yeah. As you do.
Yeah. And I mean, you used to demo the song from him and play all the instruments in it, but playing everything on an album, there's a risk associated with that, right? How did you approach this challenge?
I think I didn't have a choice. I started working on the first tracks, the first track being Runaway from the Sun. Yeah. Started working on that in, I think, September 2019. And it started just as a... just like a demo, and I thought that I'd get the basic ideas together, and then all of a sudden it started sounding fairly decent to my ears. I was pleasantly surprised, and since I'm a huge fan of Stevie Wonder, of Prince, of Lenny Kravitz, and all those people who've actually done that crazy thing,
yeah.
But you know, they've been cool enough to consider a solo album actually being a proper solo album. That I wanted to try out the. If I could pull it off, because I wasn't thinking about releasing anything. I just thought that I put a few songs together, and then I asked Tim Palmer, the mixing engineer and co-producer for the album, to just take a listen whether he thinks that, whether he thought that the songs sounded decent enough to be mixed. And he loved them. And that ended up being the first EP I released in I think it was March or April in 2020. Mm-hmm. With that EP, I was able to look for a record label, and then also test the waters to see how people would react to the music, if they're still interested in that sort of music, or if people have changed their ways completely.
Yeah.
But I was happily surprised. And then, you know, during that time, COVID hit. So there was no way of actually putting a band together. So I thought that I'd do it the Prince way. You know, until the very and also I thought it was cool because Steve Wilson does that sort of stuff too, but it was cool because it's very undiluted, and then it's quite a challenge to put all those pieces together by myself, so it's something I've never done, and I thought that it would be an insanity to try it out, but then again, like, why not? And you have to keep yourself on your toes, and you have to, especially being in the, you know, being in the recording business for such a long time. I've been involved. I've been sort of like secretly spying on the little tricks of the trade, tools of the trade, and tricks of the trade of a lot of great producers and mixing engineers. So I had an inkling what can be interpreted as a decent sound, but you have to be a bit mad to do that. But then again, why not?
You know? Yeah. Of course, because you can, right?
Then at the end of the day, you have to remember that I didn't have to release the album, or I didn't have to release the EP. So it wasn't. I always had to had sort of my back door open, so I could sneak away if it started to sound really bad. But I thought that, you know, it gives a very honest, very straightforward, very undiluted, very uncompromised vision of one person in good and in bad.
Yeah.
So there's something beautiful about it, because it's also this time around, you can, if you don't dig it, you know, I'm the one to blame, and I'm fine with that, because there's no like, well, but we decided to do this because of this and that. There's none of that. So
And one thing I find rare in music these days is, and the album does have that in songs like Baby Lacrimarium, for example, is pop songs with guitars. Why do you think pop music these days got rid of guitars almost completely?
Oh, actually, you could put it, you could say in a way that why did rock music on the charts lack all the guitars these days?
Yeah, yeah.
If you think of a lot of rock charts, you know, it does very, I can't remember what it was, Spotify or whatever, but Billie Eilish was on the rock charts. Very high
doesn't
up.
Doesn't make sense, right?
I can't remember what the song was. It did have some guitars in it, but... To me, I have to consider the album. I think an album needs an ebb and flow. It needs a roller coaster ride, and it needs to go to weird places and interesting places. And you need to have album tracks as well. You need to have tracks that don't necessarily open so fast. You know, working, trying to go back to the 50s and work on 2.5 minute singles and make a 10 out of them doesn't make a great album. It might make 10 great singles, but I think. Being a fan of Pink Floyd and Type O Negative and all those bands that made album into an art form and this weird, weird journey. I think, and you know, I designed anyway, Neo Noir to be, it's a gatefold double vinyl. Mm-hmm. So it's the kooky weird slower, doomier, more psychedelic tracks are on album two, and the album one is more of the rock stuff. And that inspiration I got from Ritual de la Habitual by Jane's Addiction. They had side A being rock tracks and side B being all the weird psychedelic stuff. So that's quite a different art form than just speculating what's on the rock charts these days or pop these days. So I don't think that as a songwriter or a musician, you should be restricting yourself because something makes sense. Making sense and music don't go hand in hand, you know?
Yeah.
At least in my world. And I thought it was pretty risky, Baby Like Her Marion, for me to go so The Cure with the gentle guitars. It has that sort of 90s, early 90s alt rock vibe to it. And I thought, oh, is this too pretty? But and I thought that, you know, considering the whole album, it's good to be a bit pretty at times. And then the lyrics are really freaky on that one. So it's once again the juxtaposition of all those different weird, seemingly unfitting things coming together and hopefully making some sort of weird sense at the end of the journey.
Yes, of course. And one of my favorite songs you mentioned earlier, Run Away from the Sun. It's not a sentence I would expect from someone from Finland. If anything, you'd be running towards the sun, right?
Well, I'm not quite sure. You know, we do. There's a sense of there's a sense of safety in the darkness, and I just thought that it's a very inviting love song, especially when the winter is coming and the sun is nowhere to be seen, and it's also maybe about not being afraid to embrace the mistakes we make in life. To embrace the more, not necessarily negative, but the more melancholy aspects we all have to deal with somehow. I think the whole album, that's the title for the album, Neon Noir, it's like radiating darkness. It's like, let's celebrate the bad things because we all go through them and hopefully we learn from them. We become better persons and we're ready to make new mistakes again. You know, it's that process, I guess. And so for me, it doesn't have anything to do with negativity or sort of old school depression where life loses its meaning. Nothing makes sense anymore. And death is the only option. Sort of like that very old school way of thinking. It doesn't have anything to do with that. It has more to do with this wistful sense of nostalgia and the beauty and the bittersweet beauty of longing and thinking about something you've lost in the past, but you've been so blessed to actually have in your hands back in the day, something you've experienced, something you've lost along the way, but having the experience is way better than never having felt it. So I think that's the sort of like the scale of emotions I like to, these days, I like to, that's the place where I belong, I guess.
Awesome. Well, at the risk of sounding literal once again, let me ask about Loveletting, where you talk about two heartbeats out of sync with one another. Of course, I mean, to me, it sounds like a breakup song. Does that come from personal experience in any way or?
Yeah, it always does. I think it's very important. I've never understood the fact that when you become a semi-successful rock musician, you have to turn into an actor. And so I always thought that the strength in music is that you are who you are as you are with all your faults. And you know, Neil Young is my hero and Nick Cave is my hero and people like that who are very honest and very truthful regarding what they're on about. But yeah, Loveletting, it's quite a weird song because it's quite upbeat to a certain extent sound-wise. And that was a song that I had the hardest time with. I think it was beginning of 2021 when it seemed that we're losing another summer. There's not going to be anything going on. Nobody actually knows if it's ever going to end. It was quite a lot of tombstones around, you know. It was, I think, the sort of like the positivity in the song, the sound of the song came from the fact that the world was so dark. I had to forcefully create some sort of tenderness in the production to sort of forget about dark clouds on top of everybody's heads at that time. But Loveletting, I think it's, for me, the essential bit is that there is two hearts It's not a one heart beating by itself. So there's two hearts out of sync is better than one heart by itself. And it does mean that there's a chance for them to resync, or that they were in sync, which is once again better than not having experienced that at all. So I think the song for me is more about maybe trying to figure out when there are situations when letting go is more of the right loving thing to do than holding on to something. And that's quite a fine line, at least in my, you know, trying to figure out which makes the most sense. And once again, the matters of the heart don't necessarily make sense. So that it's about the sort of like the dream line, the dreamlike cusp of holding on and letting go. That's the sort of like, that's the dancing on the razor's edge, so to speak. So that's what it's all about, trying to figure out. Trying to still figure out the things I've been trying to figure out since I was 40.
That's awesome. Yeah. And I think, you know, you mentioned being able to dance to these songs. Lyrically, it seems that you're dealing with feelings of not belonging, but it sounds to me like a happy album overall, right? Am I right in saying that? Yeah.
Oh, no. Well, I've never considered myself of a, well, that's a tough one. I think the album has a sense of peace to it. It doesn't sound forced. It doesn't sound pretentious. And it has a sense of flow of a person who's not in a terrible rush to shout out on the barricades that you people need to do this, or you need to believe in this or that. I think it has that sort of, sort of zen-like sentimentality.
If, not patronizing in any way, right?
Yeah, sort of. It's not so teeny angsty, which I find, especially musically, which I find that is the difference to a lot of the hymn stuff. You know, it's not so pushed. It's sort of like it has this big Lebowski sort of vibe to it.
Right.
if Lebowski would have been a goth.
Yeah,
you know? so I like that. That's where I'm headed, headed towards, I guess.
Got it. Yeah, and I think
the Godfella abides.
Yeah, I like that. Yeah, and the Forever Lost is another highlight for me. It reminds me of an '80s band, but I can't quite put my finger on it. Bauhaus, The Mission, or The Cult. Something like that. I don't know if I'm right or wrong, but
there's no rhyme or reason. You know, I think all of that is right because I've listened to all those bands, but usually 99.9% of the time when you're working a song, you go by instinct and feel. And of course there's similarities because nobody's trying to reinvent the wheel here. You know, it's about bearing the torch for the, you know, for the greats, so to speak. So
I thought
then the choruses remind me of Interpol a bit from New York City. Yeah. They have that sort of like the post Joy Division-y, that one string, da 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 da. It has that, all that coming together. Probably the first song ever with a 16th beat on the hi-hat and some 909 kicks. So that was the last song I worked on for the album. So for me, it's the most fresh. But I think it's a combo. It's quite a weird song. Once again, it has a pretty massive riff and the verses are very kind of, what do you call it, like a goth ABC. It has all the jangly, weird guitars a la Mission, and then very low and high vocals at the same time. And it's my hats off to that genre. But it's tough for me to say because it's a lot of little details that make the difference for me. The pre-choruses, I love the Suicide by Hearts, Night Vision Hearts. Loves Night Vision Hearts. I think that's the one of the key phrases to the whole album. It sums up a lot of things in such a sort of like concise fashion, you know. But it's very 80s, and a lot of times when working on a song, it reflects up from the song you worked before. I think the second to the last was Heartful of Ghosts, which is very slow and meandering and moody. So after that, it was like with him albums, you know, we did one more hard-hitting album. And since touring that for a year and a half, we wanted to try out something different. And that usually ended up being something a bit more slick and maybe a bit more pop. So with this album, because I worked on one song at a time, finished one song at a time, I was kind of like making this mini album. So I could always reflect, okay, this is done, this sounds like this. I don't want to do the same now. I want to do something else. Right. So that made the album how it is at the moment and why it has this sort of strange role to it.
Yeah.
But but I guess you're absolutely right about all the 80s influences and those were the days for me.
Yeah, for me too. I'm 48 now, so yes, definitely in that age range.
I just turned 46, so yeah. We're exactly. We'll be listening to exactly the same stuff, more or less.
Yeah. And I mean, now that you're a free agent and you're not in him mm-hmm. anymore, is there a chance of you doing more partnerships like the one you did with Bloodhound Gang or Cradle of Filth? Do you think that there would be more room for that? Or
sure. I think a lot of times. The whole feat game, featuring this and that, as it also easily becomes a bit forced, and it becomes too
commercial. Yeah.
It's something I didn't involve, for example, on the album, because Tim, the co-producer and the mixing engineer for the album, he was suggesting like, why not? You know, we have a lot of common friends who are, you know, great talents. Why shouldn't we ask somebody to play on a song or whatever? But I thought that that sort of like dilutes the whole vibe. If every song is featuring something and also with the little guest work I've done in the past, I thought that all of that stuff has happened very organically by the artist actually asking me. And, you know, it's not been record company sort of business that now it would make sense to do this and this, you know, right before that, whatever. But that being said, I'm discussing a couple of cool possibilities. So I can't tell you anything about them yet, but
okay.
But yeah, but you all know, right. I'm like a virus.
Okay. fair enough. And a few years ago, you did a few shows as Rambo Rimbo. Any chance of you repeating that experience and releasing music under that name, or?
No, that was one of the sort of titles or monikers for this project originally as well. But then I thought that. But there were probably going to be some problems using the name Rambo, even though it's not by the writer of the original books. Rambo, as far as I understand, is a name of a Swedish apple. So it's a Swedish name from many, many a moon ago. But I thought that, you know, it's R&R. That would have made sense, you know, in the realm of rock and roll. And I just love both of those names being pronounced the same way, even though they're both the polar opposites. I had made a cool logo as well with a quill and a knife.
Oh.
it was pretty cool. But no. It was, I think the Rambo was me trying to get to this point, and which ended up me just using the initials so it's easy to Google. It looks better. It has that Black Sabbath thing going on, and then especially abroad, my name is still fairly exotic, so. Tidal and Spotify and all those, you know, the search engines aren't the best.
Yeah.
So if you miss one letter, you won't be able to find it. And I didn't want that to happen. So I thought that VV makes all the sense in the world. It's just quick.
Yeah. I think, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but Rambo Rimbo and the album you did with Agents as well is you sort of testing the waters a little bit and thinking about the future back then, right?
But it's also about going with instinct. You know, the music I with Agents, the Finnish band, the music they play is sort of like Shadows influence, so like guitar music from the 50s, so in essence very Twin Peaksy. And the album we did together right after him was disbanded was a cover album filled with songs by a Finnish pop singer from the 70s and 80s. The important thing being for me personally, the fact that that's the music my parents were listening to when they were young, and the music I was they forced me to listen to when I was a baby. So that's the music from mother's mouth, you know. My dad used to listen to like Motown and all sorts of stuff from all over the place, but the Finnish music I remember really well. So it was my way of kind of saying thank you to my parents and actually being able for the first time to perform at clubs and gigs that my parents would approve. You know, honestly approved. They're not dissing rock and roll at all, but at the end of the day, I thought that that's like now he's a real musician.
Right.
You know,
right. Validation.
Yeah. 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 Validation. Yeah. Singing at a jazz festival or something like that. Yeah. So I think I needed to do it to sort of like to get the excuse to be able to do this again.
Fair enough. Fair enough. And I imagine now you're doing pre-production for the live shows next year and putting a band together, right? How's that going?
Oh, yeah. Well, I got the band. The musicians are fantastic. It's just about what I ordered. I definitely didn't want to have a band that would be a carbon copy of him. Yeah. So I didn't want to have similar sort of characters with similar sort of influences. It was really important for me to more maybe dive deeply into the influence of neo-noir. And through that, I was hoping to find some musicians that were more on the lines of, let's say, Queens of Stone Age or Radiohead, somewhere in between. Mm-hmm. Because there's a lot of that alto guitar work and all that. I thought that it would benefit from musicians who are familiar with that world. And I was able to find a really, really good posse. They're local musicians. They're well-known here. They've toured with very big acts here. So they're super pro, but they're not internationally well-known. And they're more like hired gun type of guys. They're younger than me, most mm-hmm. of them. One is only, I think, one of the guitar players is only 26 maybe or something. But he's the baby of the band. But they're great guys. I've learned a lot from them. And it's been fun to teach them how to do big pick slides. Because that's out of their comfort zone completely. So I'll be like, no, you got to turn it like that to sound more typo. And Mick Morris is more like this and that. And
it's been
much fun. And the difference production and sound-wise for this tour is that we're having two guitar players and a bass player and a drummer. And the keyboards are coming from backing tapes. Because there's so much stuff going on the album Neo-Noir that I would have needed three keyboard players for that, plus a choir. So I ended up doing utilizing a lot of the backing vocals from the album, and I tracked bazillion tracks of backing vocals for all the hymn tracks we're playing live. So so that'd be kind of cool, because actually now the hymn tracks will sound closer to the album versions than they did when him played them live, because now we're able to do the interplay with between a more prettier guitar and a more hard hitting guitar. And it sounds, I think it sounds a bit fuller, but of course it won't be the same thing. So if you're nostalgically inclined, you know, it will never be the same. And that's definitely something I don't want to try. It doesn't make any, it's trying to bring some of the old tracks closer to the new sound, but it's still, the new sound is very much the old sound in essence. So it's nothing new around this particular song. So, or mood, I should say, being so politically inclined, it's done a great work. We're putting the set together. It'll be half and half of hymn songs and the new ones. And it's not going to be so that we play all the new songs first and then there would be a hymn encore. I've never liked that much, you know, when I've seen bands do that live. So I prefer to be zigzagging between the now and the past.
Yeah,
so
mix it up.
And also, and then I think the older sounds, the older songs, they sound fantastic. They get this new, or I get a new perspective when you play, let's say you play Echolocate Your Love, and then the next song is Rip Out the Wings of a Butterfly. You play the Foreverlost, and then you play Right to Your Moms.
Yeah.
Because they do share similarities, and then there's a beauty to that sort of patchwork, you might call it, you know.
Of course,
that sonic quilt will be tremendous.
Yeah, so, it's a scientific art to put together a set list, that's for sure.
It can be, but then again, I have to be really happy about the fact that it was more about not trying to figure out which songs to put into the set list, but trying to figure out which songs not to put in the set list, because there's so many, especially hymn songs, that I find essential. Mm-hmm. So there's easily 10, 15 hymn songs you can skip playing.
Yeah.
So that made it easier. That kind of, you know, that gave me an ego rub for a nanosecond before I remembered who I am.
Yeah. Well, Ville, we're wrapping up. You don't have a date set in Toronto yet, but I'm hoping that it's going to be arranged soon. I know you have like 50 odd dates next year, so I look forward to seeing you.
And we're hoping to continue. The idea is not for the tour to be finished. at the summer festival time, but to continue until the very end of the year. So I'm also hoping that we're going to have the chance to play in places like Australia, Mexico City, Argentina, Brazil, Japan, hopefully. That'd be amazing. So
yeah.
But we're hoping it'll be a proper worldwide tour, and Canada is definitely included.
Awesome. Thank you so much, man. Thank you so much.
Thank all the best for your album. Till next time. All right.
Bye. Bye.